The next four talks are all tied together. And we're going to shift to the Willamette Valley and then also to also the Gorge AVA, which is not too far away. And so I'm going to be followed up. I'm going to give two things about the Willamette Valley and soils in general. The next speaker is going to be one of my PhD students who just recently finished up, and we're going to be talking about her research into the different soils and their effect on terroir. Then Greg Ritalik and I have a paper that recently came out. He's going to follow up, also looking at soils and terroir in the valley, and then we're going to go up to the gorge. And so this is up, actually, in the gorge, taken from Underwood Mountain. This is for Ray, who is in Underwood. And so what I'm going to be, let's see, there we go. What I'm going to be doing is, give you just a little bit of background on me, and then definition of terroir. And Diego did a great job because I totally agree with what you had there before. Talk about soils and their relationship to terroir, and then end up with the terroir of the Willamette Valley. I have been involved in wines ever since I was in university. I went to a university in California called Stanford, and my friends and I would go up to this fledgling new area to go wine tasting that was just starting out. You could do the whole valley from one end to the other end. It's called the Napa Valley. This was back in the 60s. You can't do that today, and it's a lot more developed there. Then I finished up, and I went to Switzerland, and I taught in Switzerland for 5 years. And I actually made wine in the classes because it teaches a lot of biology and chemistry at the same time. And so here is a picture of me in Switzerland in 1973 as a young professor doing this. And in fact, professors always have to publish, and so my first paper I ever published was in the Journal of College Science Teaching in 1976, and it's Science Can Be Fun and Tasty, Winemaking in the Lab. And then I grew up here. I'm a sixth generation Oregonian. I came back here in 1990, and for the last 26 years, I've been at Portland State University, not too far away. And I got re-involved with soils because I'm a pedologist and a geologist, and looking at the soils of wine country. And so anytime I give a talk on terroir, and I give quite a few, I always define what terroir is, and all of us have different definitions. And Diego used this exact thing, so thank you for doing that. And the number one, grape varieties that we have got. In the Willamette Valley here, we have 12 different varieties. We have the Pommard and Vadensville, but then all of the Dijon ones too to go along with that. And then you have rootstocks that are involved in that. Secondly, I'm going to be focusing in on geology and soils. Yesterday, we did huge amounts on climate, and everybody knows the importance of climate that we have got here. And soil hydrology. Here we basically dry land farm, and so you need to have a little bit of silt and clay in the soil in order to hold water for the end of the season when it gets very, very dry, because we have 3 months of basically no rainfall. And then physiography, elevations are very, very important here. Our two numbers are generally about 100 meters. Below that, you've got Missoula floods, not a good idea, and then above 300 meters, you have a reduction in the chances for ripening, but as the climate seems to warm up, that keeps rising up. And so this is what I traditionally have been calling terroir. But there are two other factors that are huge. The winemaker, Christian, earlier today, talked about all of the decisions that the winemaker has to make, and it's unbelievable. They control the whole thing. Here in Oregon, in a good year, the winemaker sits back and lets the wine make themselves. But in a difficult year, like 2007 and 2011, where we had a cool climate the whole time and wet, the winemaker has to step up. And they make all the decisions from yeast and oak and many things like that. And then vineyard management, and again, Christian mentioned all of the different differences that we have got. Those two are very, very important, but for me, I don't consider those especially terroir. When I talk about terroir, I always talk about it being the taste of the place. A lot of people use sense of the place. We thank the French for this term, which is absolutely wonderful. It's the total elements of the vineyard that we talked about and all of those I mentioned before. The geology, I'm going to be focusing in on the soils, the texture, everything that we have got, the orientation of the slope, etc. And the interesting thing, our impact on the rest of the world, terroir is now being used for so many different foods. Whether it is coffee, hops, you are in the land of microbrews, and now everybody talks about the terroir of the hops that we have got. I gave a talk in Vermont back east, and they talk about the terroir of the different maple syrups, cheeses, and the list goes on. And now in Oregon, we have started a program at Portland State in the terroir of marijuana because it is now legal in this state. And so one of the young assistant professors is taking that over, and especially in the southern part of the state. And when I talk about terroir, Greg and I had a discourse with Alex Maltman, who is a geologist and a terroir guy from England, and we really need to talk about what we are talking about. First of all, he said, there's minerality. And minerality is terroir, and you can actually taste the quartz or the phyllite or the slate that is in the wine. And here in the Willamette Valley, I don't think we can. I think we have differences in flavors, and the differences in flavors we can attribute to the geology and the soils that we have got, in addition to all of the other things that happen that are out there. And also, as you know, we have three major transparent grapes. Where the terroir comes through. The terroir comes through in all grapes. But especially with our heavier reds, we are over-ripening them, and they are being overshadowed, and the terroir is not coming through as well. But Rieslings, the Germans have been showing us that for years and years, and all of the different vineyards and the different flavors that you have as the geology changes, etc. Chardonnay is another one that does this, but many times we over-oak this. But here in Oregon, we're backing off on the oak and getting some of those flavors coming through. And then the thin skin, red grape, Pinot Noir, it really can show terroir. And I've given talks around the world talking about my favorite place to taste differences in terroir is the Willamette Valley. And that's why I welcome all of you to Oregon, because hopefully you will be able to taste these differences while you are here. One of our great winemakers that is here is Ken Wright. And he was on the front page, the cover of the Wine Spectator this past year. And they said, a master of Pinot Noir in Oregon. But a quote that is inside and also in the video that he did, he said, to understand Oregon wines is to understand Oregon geology. And it is very important, the geology and the soils that we have got. He has been my hero for a long time. He was one of the first guys to actually put the soils on the back label of his bottle in his single vineyard types that he had. Dick Erath, one of the original four modern winemakers in Oregon, said 80% of the quality of the wine comes from the vineyards. He's a terroirist. 20% comes from the winery. Also, I wanted to point to the Willamette Valley. And nobody's shown Greg's four classifications that we have of cool climate, intermediate, warm, and hot. But the Willamette Valley is one of the great examples of cool climate. And then when we do this, what we do is so what types of grapes do you normally find in this particular area? And it's primarily the Pinots and the German styles and the Chardonnays. Those are what traditionally grow in a cool climate type of area, and that's what we've been specializing in for a long time. And if you are going to open and develop a vineyard here, anywhere in the world, you need to have at least 180 frost-free days. Mineral nutrients, you don't have to. And for my friends who are agricultural people, we say you just have to have enough mineral nutrients to keep that plant alive. You don't want too many of them because you get too much vigor, and this is something that you want to reduce. You want well-drained soils. Your perfect vineyard is 7 to 8 degrees slope. and then the elevations that we talked about before for ripening. Frost avoidance is another problem that you have got, and so you need to get into, and then minimum temperatures that you have got. When we talk about soils, one of my heroes is Robert White, who is here. And he tells us that we have 10 macronutrients and 6 micronutrients that we need to have in the soils for proper grapes that we have got. Also, we focus in on those plus the trace elements because we have a feeling that they are going to be affecting the grapes that we have. When we look at the soils, the depth of the soil, there are 10 different things I wanted to highlight. First of all, some plants really like deep soils, like the Chardonnays, whereas the Syrahs like the more shallow soils. pH is very important. You want in that pH of the soil between 5.5 and 10. When it's too high, then the uptake of iron, copper, zinc, and manganese is reduced. Low P, low phosphorus if it is below that. Salinity will affect the uptake of the phosphorus. Texture is going to affect your water holding capacity. Structure is going to affect the root penetration and also moving machinery around. Drainage, you want to have well-drained soils. Clay content is going to affect your root penetration, the color of the soils. The darker it is, the warmer you're going to be emitting heat and therefore speeding up the ripening. Red color is indicating well-drained types of soils. Rockiness is also going to affect the maturation that you have got too, like Chateau Neuf de Pape. And then limestone is going to affect the rooting depths that you have got. I'll go by this. Let's end up with talking about Oregon. Back in 1961, this guy was the first one to plant, the one is David Lett. It was right just down the road from Stoller, where we were last night. And eventually he took his Pinot Noir to the International Pinot Noir Competition. Didn't win, but the French said, "Qu'est-ce que c'est? Oui, Oregon, what is going on here? Where is this Oregon place?" And then it has developed since that period of time. And so today in Oregon, as Greg pointed out, we have over 700 wineries and 960 vineyards, and the ratio of red to white in the state is like that. And here in the Willamette Valley, cool climates, here you've got your Pinot Noir that is the king or the queen of all of the grapes that we have got. So here is the Willamette Valley. We've subdivided it into sub-AVAs. And last night we were in the Dundee Hills sub-AVA, primarily volcanic soils. Tonight we're going to be in the McMinnville sub-AVA. Yesterday we looked to the south and the mountains to the south. That is the Iola Hills sub-AVA. And then we're going to be up in Chehalem Mountain sub-AVA. And these are defined by soils and geology they have. The interesting thing in Oregon, the winemakers worked together. When they submitted all of these sub-AVAs, they turned them all in the same day, saying, look, we are not competing. We just have differences, and we want to highlight those that we have. And so back in the 90s, nobody knew what we were growing on. What were the soils that were there? So I started out with a grad student and looked at the soils and the distribution that we had. And there were three that popped out. The first one is what we call the soil series. The second one is the geology. And the third one is the soil classification. The Joy was the largest one. The Willikinsey was second one. And Laurelwood was third. And so that is basalt, sedimentary, and then basalt with loess that is involved in that. And there were over 23 different soils that were found here in the valley. And with that, then we started publicizing the great debate. Which soil produces the best Pinot Noir? And originally we focused in on two, and now we focus in on three. And the Is It the Joy soil? Which is our state soil, and I'll show you that in a second, developed on the Columbia River basalt. Is it the Willikinsey soil, which is developed on marine sediments, or is it the Laurelwood soil? The Missoula flood sediments, the flatland that we have down here, has about 9% of all the vineyards, but they have way too much vigor, too much calcium, magnesium, potassium, and sodium that we have, and because we do dryland farming, we use old, weathered red soils to reduce that. The Columbia River basalts, where we were last year, they're volcanic, but where are the volcanoes? They were about 500 kilometers away, where in eastern Oregon, where the hot spot was, that is now underneath Yellowstone National Park, flowed over here, and those soils are 2-3 million years old. They are primarily the Joy. When you get shallower ones, we call it Nakaya, and when it gets really short or shallow, the Witzel. The marine sediments are primarily uplifted sandstones and shales. And if you get a chance down to see Ray Wells' map of the geology of the area, he has an incredible area here. And those are primarily in the Amhill County AVA. They're mapped originally as Willackenzie, but now this has been subdivided. The Melbourne is the dominant one that we have here. We still have Willackenzie, but the Wellsdale and Doopie, we're going to be on that on Wednesday night out at Adelsheim. Bell Pine, as you go further south, they're mostly alpha sols. And then the windblown one that we have on the up on Chehalem Mountain is primarily called the Laurelwood soils. I want to stress that these are old mosses. These are up to 100,000 years old, and they have little piezolites in it. These piezolites are iron, manganese, silica concretions. I've got a little bottle of those down there if anybody wants to see those. Here are the Dundee Hills. This is our state soil. This is the Joy soil that we have got. This is the Willackenzie type of soil that we have got. And then just to end with, what I just thought I would mention is tastes. And what you want to do is taste the differences. For me, many times when I would taste the Joy soils, it would come out mainly red fruits, the raspberries, the red plums, currants, and stuff like that. And also in the early days, red colors. Whereas the marine sediments were much darker in color, and then the darker fruits, the blackberries, the black cherries, the black plums. Ken Wright says, Scott, you're a geologist, you normally drink wine out of a box, what do you know? It is primarily fruit-driven flavors on the basalt soils and floral and spice on the others. And then the Laurelwood soils are kind of in between that you have got. So be sure to test these soils and taste them, because I think that you will really enjoy them. And I'm going to end right there. Thank you very much.